for Australian ballet lovers, a rare opportunity to fall beneath their spell.
But it was in the United States, especially New York, where Fonteyn and Nureyev had the biggest impact of all, and where they certainly enjoyed their greatest successes. People flocked to see their performances. Most were a sellout months in advance. Impresarios had a feast day. The American press was particularly extravagant in its praise. The hottest little team in show business was how the New York Herald Tribune irreverently dubbed them. Everyone who was anyone felt they just had to be there.
I think they were monopolized by the greatest names in the land, inside the building, certainly. But outside at the stage door, the world was waiting, and there the effect was quite amazing. I mean, I remember, particularly at the New Metropolitan, there was one lady who, every time she caught sight of Fonteyn, in fact, used to go into a catatonic fit. This was a genuine medical catatonic fit induced by external stimuli, and I imagine Rudolf sent hordes to Roosevelt Hospital. It was that sort of mania, genuine mania.
Fonteyn herself was a very, very great dancer and artist who was known to the ballet public as that, whereas Fonteyn Nureyev was this incredible phenomenon. They were a showbiz item, they were a gossip column item, and they were something that was known to people who had nothing to do with the ballet. Taxi drivers knew who they were.
Fonteyn and Nureyev's arrival in New York preceded that of the Beatles by just a few months. This was, after all, the so-called swinging 60s, but their respective impacts on that volatile populace were certainly similar. They became the focus of much clandestine, amateur filming by adoring fans. These pictures were shot surreptitiously at the New Metropolitan Opera House with handheld 8mm cameras, often hidden in mink stoles. Certainly, no two dancers ever made such a lasting impression with American audiences as they did. But although their performances might have looked effortless, there were occasions when the reality belied this.
I can remember one dress rehearsal at the Metropolitan Opera House in New York when, just prior to lunch, it was plainly apparent that both of them should have been in traction. I mean, they couldn't find one sound leg between them, and one would have to say that the rehearsal was a total disaster. And Fonteyn came off stage, actually took a look at my face, which must have been reading something, and said to everybody within earshot, including the general administrator and God knows who else, Keith thinks I should retire now and not wait for this evening's performance. And I made some silly remark about, well, why don't you announce it after lunch? And off we went. Anyway, that evening, the limousines and the millions of dollars worth of diamonds and God knows what poured down Broadway, and the house was full, and indeed the performance took place. And one would have to say that it was certainly a very cautious performance for two-thirds of the time. But just at that psychological moment when you thought, this is not going to work, Rudolf pulled out a series of turns from God knows where, and she followed it by fluttering downstage and going up onto point and holding an arabesque while she gazed around the auditorium, almost as if she'd forgotten that she was up on point. And being in the audience, it was just like being in an earthquake. I mean, the entire place fell in, screaming like an extraordinary rock concert.
American audiences are much more demonstrative than English ones anyway. I don't think they're necessarily more appreciative, but they have another way of showing it. They applaud when somebody stands on point, they applaud when somebody jumps high, they applaud when somebody does one pirouette, let alone 25. And they yell and they scream when something pleases them. Theater programs in New York, at any rate, are free. So people would accumulate a stack of them. At the end of the performance, they'd go up to the two sides of the gods at the very top of the family circle at the Old Met, and they would shred them into confetti and throw them down on the audience and on the stage at the end. A And then there were huge presentations of flowers and things afterwards, of course. But we had never seen anything like it. We'd never seen curtain calls like the curtain calls that Nureyev initiated and that are now copied worldwide. I mean, Margot had taken curtain calls, all the other dancers had taken curtain calls, but it was quite a sedate thing. They came out and they were applauded, and occasionally there was a standing ovation. But for this, and the drama that was brought into it with Nureyev kissing her hand, and everybody applauded more every time he kissed her hand, and then they'd come out separately and together, and the whole cast would come out, and sometimes it went on for 4 to 5 minutes. We had never seen anything like that before. It was part of the performance, and it was so exciting at the time because it was so new.
Fonteyn and Nureyev's exposure in the United States was not just confined to New York. Middle America got its chance when they appeared on TV's highest-rated show, fronted by Ed Sullivan.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, and the country in Canada and Australia, live from New York, in two solo variations in the pas de deux from Swan Lake, English ballet star Margot Fonteyn and Rudolf Nureyev. So let's have a wonderful round.
In June 1964, Margot Fonteyn's husband was shot in Panama City by a political associate. One of the bullets struck his spine, and as a result, he became paralyzed. He was brought to Stoke Mandeville Hospital in Britain for treatment and rehabilitation, but the paralysis proved irreversible, and he remains a quadriplegic. 2 years later, he and Margot were able to return to Panama, where he at least has lived ever since. Remarkably, he was also able, at first, to continue his political activities.
The Arias family tend to be more often in opposition than on the government side, especially Tito, who is an unusual character. He doesn't belong in any class. He's at home with all people. So he started to feel more and more that he wanted to have some influence in politics. And in order to do this in Panama, it's really almost essential to be a deputy in the National Assembly, because deputies have immunity from arrest. So then he ran for deputy, and he was elected by a very big vote. And as an almost direct result of that, he was shot 2 weeks later.
Margot spent as much time as she could with Tito, but on occasion her dancing career beckoned her away, and there were also financial considerations. The role for which she and Nureyev will perhaps be most remembered is Romeo and Juliet, choreographed in 1965 by Kenneth MacMillan to Prokofiev's magnificent music. Thank you.